church on this lovely Victoria Day weekend. The official start of summer, so we started with a tornado yesterday and a lot of rain. Perfect, yes, this is what we need. Anyway, so a couple of announcements today. Last year, Charlotte, Mary Lou, and Brian got together, looked at all the fabric of the church. You've already heard this probably. So we have some stucco work to do at the back. We had the soffits and fascia capped with aluminum. And we also did some painting. We hired someone to do some painting. And they're going to finish the painting and stucco work this year. We had a great year last year. People contributed wonderfully. We've run out of money. So if you want to give more for the outside of the church, that would be great. Of course, our hope is that, you know, it's our 150th. And hopefully, as we take care of the fabric of the church will be around another 150 years, at least. So if you can contribute, that would be great. If you can't, just pray for us that someone else will. That's all we're really looking for. So anyway, if you have any questions about any of the repairs or what's going on, you can ask. Brian's here and Mary Lou's here. You can ask them, no problem. You can ask me if you want to, but I don't know anything about it, so it's just the way it is. So I'll tell you whatever. A celebration of life for service for Bob Gibson is happening next Saturday, the 28th, at 11:30 here in the church, and then there will be a reception in the hall to follow. Also next Saturday is Marion Bagshaw's 80th birthday drop-in at the Eudora Hall from 2 to 4. So for some of you, it'll be a very busy day, but two celebrations of two staunch parishioners at the church. So consider that. The ACW is having their Jubilee Tea from 2 to 4 on June the 4th to celebrate the Queen's 70th year on the throne. And as a primer for that, today David and Janice are doing coffee hour with a little bit of taste of what it's going to be like. So we celebrate, of course, in Victoria Day, we celebrate the collective birthdays of all royalty. That's just kind of the way it is. And so it's going to be really wonderful. And as I said, Britishness is greatly encouraged. So, you know, bring out your British stuff. You know how it is. Some of you don't have to worry about it too much. You know it. But anyway, so should be a lot of fun. Sign-up sheets still in the hall for greeters and for coffee hour. So please consider volunteering for these ministries. Mary Lou is wonderful. She fills in when there's no one signed up, but if you could sign up, that would be great. Even if it's just greeting at the door, you can see people again that you haven't seen for a while, have a little chit-chat perhaps. The flowers on the altar are given the honor and glory of God, given for the people of Ukraine, and that's by Dale and Larry. We thank them for that today. As well, if you need a larger, I had a discussion with a parishioner last week. Sometimes, and I'm getting older, so I know exactly what it's like. Sometimes you can't read the little writing that's in the books, right? Especially, I got to tell you, especially the hymn book, I get confused about which verse I'm on. I sing the wrong stuff. It's just the way it is. So we do have larger print hymn books if you need those, or the smaller ones. They just have the words in it, lyrics. They don't have the music. And we also have service books that I've made up that are much larger font. So if you need those, please tell me. We have a few available. And every week they'll be updated, obviously, with the Eucharistic prayer and with the hymns. So please remember that as you go along. I think that's it. Are there any other announcements I'm missing? All right. Well, that's great. Great to see you here on a holiday weekend. Of course, someone says, what are you doing your holiday weekend, Reverend Ted? I'm working, because that's Sunday. It's just kind of the way it is on a holiday weekend for me. So our processional hymn is number 278 in your blue hymn books. Jerusalem the Gold, number 278. book of alternative services, page 185, in the middle of the page. Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
May his grace and peace be with you.
May he fill our hearts with joy.
Almighty God, to you
all hearts are open, all desires are known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Chapter 16, verses 9 to 15. During the night, Paul had a vision. There stood a man of Macedonia there, pleading with him and saying, "Come over to Macedonia and help us." When he had seen the vision, we immediately tried to cross over to Macedonia, being convinced that God had called us to proclaim the good news to them. We set sail from Troas and took a straight course to Samothrace, the following day to Neapolis, and from there to Philippi, which is a leading city of the district of Macedonia and a Roman colony. We remained in this city for some days. On the Sabbath day, we went outside the gate by the river, where we supposed there was a place of prayer, and we sat down and spoke to the women who had gathered there. A certain woman named Lydia, a worshiper of God, was listening to us. She was from the city of Thyatira and a dealer in purple cloth. The Lord opened her heart to listen eagerly to what was said by Paul. When she and her household were baptized, she urged us, saying, "If you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come and stay at my home." And she prevailed upon us. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Psalm appointed for this morning is Psalm number 67, and you can find it starting on page 788 in your green service books. Psalm number 67 on page 788. It's only seven verses, so we can probably handle it all together. May God be merciful to us and bless us. Show us the light of his countenance and come to us. Let your ways be known upon earth, your saving help among all nations. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy. For you judge the peoples with equity and guide all the nations upon earth. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. The earth has brought forth her increase. May God, our own God, give us his blessing. May God give us his blessing, and may all the ends of the earth stand in awe of him. Blessed are you, Lord our God, light of the earth and health of the nations. You lead us in the way of justice and mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now the second.
The second reading is the Revelation to John, chapter 21, beginning at the 10th verse. And in the Spirit, he carried me away to a great high mountain and showed me the holy city Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God. It has the glory of God and a radiance like a very rare jewel, like jasper, clear as crystal. It has a great high wall with 12 gates, and at the gates, 12 angels. And on the gates are inscribed the names of the 12 tribes of the Israelites. On the east, 3 gates. On the north, 3 gates. On the south, 3 gates. And on the west, 3 gates. And the wall of the city has 12 foundations. And on them are the 12 names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. The angel who talked to me had a measuring rod of gold to measure the city and its gates and walls. The city lies foursquare, its length the same as its width. And he measured the city with his rod, 1,500 miles, its length and width and height are equal. He also measured its wall, 144 cubits, by human measurement, which the angel was using. The wall is built of jasper, while the city is pure gold, clear as glass. The foundations of the wall are adorned with every jewel. The first was jasper, the second sapphire, the third agate, the fourth emerald, the fifth onyx, the sixth carnelian, the seventh chrysolite, the eighth beryl, the ninth topaz, the tenth chrysoprase, the 11th jacinth, and the 12th amethyst. And the 12 gates are 12 pearls. Each of the gates is a single pearl, and the street of the city is pure gold, transparent as glass. I saw no temple in the city, for its temple is the Lord God, the Almighty, and the Lamb. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Our gospel gravel hymn is number 341 in your blue hymn books. God of mercy, God of grace. We'll sing the first two verses before the gospel and verse number 3 afterwards, number 341.
Thank you.
be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, according to St. John.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
After this, there was a festival of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now in Jerusalem, by the sheep gate, there was a pool, called in Hebrew, Bethesda, which has five porticos. In these lay many invalids, blind, lame, and paralyzed. One man was there who had been ill for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he had been there a long time, he said to him, "Do you want me to make you well?" And the sick man answered him, "Sir, I have no one to put me in the pool when the water is stirred up. And while I'm making my way, someone else steps in ahead of me." Jesus said to him, "Stand up, take your mat, and walk." At once the man was made well, and he took up his mat and began to walk. This is the Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
The readings today show us that you should always expect the unexpected when you're talking about God, and especially Jesus. So we have this story from Acts where we just have sort of this woman Lydia who comes along, and she believes and has her whole family, her whole household baptized. Now, not much is known of Lydia after this, but she is venerated in a few, I think the Orthodox Church, the Ukrainian Orthodox Church actually, and also in the Roman Catholic Church. In this reading from Revelation, we see that although a lot's going on, the number 12 exists time after time after time. And let's remember that in the Old Testament, there are some writers of the Old Testament that really are very specific about numbers, measurements, years, people, all of that stuff. It means a lot that these numbers all add up. And that's what's happening in Revelation, right? 12 tribes of Israel, 12 this, 12 that, 144 miles, 12 by 12. These are things that are very important to the author because they show the consistency of the message, of the perfection that God has created. And finally, in this gospel reading, which I think, even though it's incredibly short, what we see is we see the unexpected that happens even when people have seen what Jesus can do in healing and other things. So this whole scene of this man who has been sick for an awful long time, I want you to imagine that, see, these pools were pools of not only relaxation, but also of healing, of rejuvenation. And so he's been sick for an awful long time, and he keeps going day after day, week after week, month after month, year after year, because he wants to experience that relief, wants to experience what it's like to be healed. Maybe not fully cured, but certainly healed, at least that day. And what he finds is what we find a lot of in our society, as he's waiting patiently in line. And as he goes up, he's a little bit slow, and someone maybe younger and faster goes in front of him, and there's no room anymore, and he goes back to his mat. He does not receive that relief he is looking for. He does not receive that hope, that relief of pain that he's hoping for. And so when Jesus comes along, he sees him lying there, and he says, "What do you want?" The guy says, "Well, you know, every day this happens and I don't know what to do." And even when Jesus says, "Well, if you want healing, I'll give it to you," I'm paraphrasing, the man says, "Okay, all I want is for someone to help me into the pool." He still doesn't quite get the scope of what Jesus is saying. And finally, Jesus just says, "Look, stand up and take your mat and just go home. You're now healed. This is over." And the man does that and he leaves. How many times have we seen someone in distress or want who is looking for food or money or help or whatever, and I know I do this, and we walk by. We don't stop and help. We're too busy with our own lives. We're too busy with what we're doing to really worry about them. That's what happens to this man for 36 some odd years. Everyone walks by him. Everyone cuts ahead of him. Everyone just says, forget it. Now, some of them are probably very religious people and say, well, he's caused himself some sin he's done, or his father, or his uncle, or whatever. Too bad for you. But that's not what Jesus does. Jesus comes along and looks at him and sees that he has that desire to be healed. He sees that his faith is still great. And instead of just taking him to the pool, he puts his hand down and he says, just get up and go home. Take your mat and walk. You will be for others an example of what it's like to be faithful in a very specific way. And I think I have to be careful, because many times we look at this and you say, well, I guess I'm not faithful enough to be healed by God like this guy, so I must be a sinner or something like that. God uses us in different ways, heals us in different ways. Many in the congregation have had some medical issues that have been incredibly cured by modern medicine, or by, you know, physiotherapy or something else. Pain that you've had for a long time, or something that has gone wrong, and you have sought medical help and you have been cured. Everything's okay. Others are not as lucky. And I think, as my friend David would say, sometimes it's just a matter of luck, right? Sometimes it's just your gene pool. It's just the way it is. But what we have to remember is that no matter what we think our limitations are, God presents us with these opportunities to help others in very specific ways. I think I've told the story before that back when I was in seminary, like a long time ago in the 90s, there was a story going around that there was a seminary in the States that did a little experiment. So what they had was all the graduating seminarians had to go for their final interview before they graduated. And it was sort of a test as well. So you can imagine that after spending all those years in study and wanting to be ordained and getting your MDiv, that they were preoccupied with the questions that they would be asked. They were preoccupied with, well, is this make or break? If I blow this, will that mean that I don't graduate, that I won't get ordained? And so they were fixated on themselves and what they were doing. And from where they were seated to where the faculty was going to interview them, there was a long hallway. This was at university, so, you know, people milling around. And there was someone that they put there who needed help, someone who was begging for money or food or whatever. And as the seminarians walked by, they were so focused on their own issues, they were so focused on getting to where they had to go, that they ignored this person. They just walked by. Some of them might not have seen them at all. Some of them said, well, I don't have time for this. Some of them said, like, who cares? And the interesting thing was, that was the test. The test was, will you give up something of yours, even a bit of time, to help someone in need? How many of you think the seminarians passed for the most part? No one. Exactly. Well, Sylvia, you're such an optimist. I know. The fact is that most of them walked by, consumed with their own thoughts, consumed with their own cares. And that's the thing that Jesus wants us to avoid. Because there are opportunities all around us to help others. Might not be as spectacular as this healing story. I know that. But how many times have we engaged with someone who needs help and found out that what they really needed was just someone to care for them, someone to act like we love you, someone to talk to? They might have been looking for food or money or transport somewhere, but the truth is that they just wanted someone to care. They wanted to have someone there with them who could feel their pain, who could alleviate some of their cares, who gave them some hope. That's what we're called to do today. These stories exist because Jesus wants to tell us that there is an opportunity to help other people, to set aside ourselves, to set aside who we are and the society that we live in that is always about me, 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 and to live out the gospel, to help other people. Doesn't have to be spectacular, doesn't have to be world-changing, although for that person you might actually change their world. Just helping someone do something, someone who's struggling, someone who's hungry, someone who needs an ear. These are all things that we can do and should do. But in order to do that, we have to give up sometimes our own focus on ourselves. We have to say there's something more important. I can be a little bit late for that meeting, or I can be a little bit late for that thing that I want to do, or I might have to do it tomorrow because I'm helping someone. There are so many things that we can do that we're presented with, opportunities for ministry and for love, to show that even though we are part of this society, it does not control us, because we are given a commandment from God to do something different. Even though we're Anglicans and, you know, we're relatively law-abiding citizens for the most part, we are counterculture. We are the opposite of this world. We realize it's not about us. It's about others. It's not about what I can do for myself. It's about what I can do for other people. It's not what I can accumulate, but what I can give. And in that, our Lord gives us a very definite and clear message. We stop. We put our hand down and we help. We listen. We care. That is who we are as Christians, as followers of Christ. And so we should continue to be. Let this for us, a couple of weeks from Pentecost, let this for us be a lesson that as we go forward to care for others more than we care for ourselves, because in doing that, we truly live out the gospel message. Amen. We continue on page 189 in your green service books with the Apostles' Creed. Will the congregation please stand? Page 189. Let us confess the faith of our baptism as we say, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please turn with me to page 122 for lady number 15 for the season of Easter. Page 122. In joy and hope, let us pray to the source of all life, saying, hear us, Lord of glory. That our risen Savior may fill us with the joy of his holy and life-giving resurrection, let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That isolated and persecuted churches may find fresh strength in the Easter Gospel, let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That he may grant us humility to be subject to one another in Christian love, let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That he may provide for those who lack food, work, or shelter, let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That by his power wars and famine may cease through all the earth, let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That he may reveal the light of his presence to the sick, the weak, and the dying. Pray especially for Lily, Tom, Ernie, Joe, Carol, Joan, Charlotte, Karen, Maddie, Linda, Kayla, Iva, Nicholas, Paul. Pray for all those living in long-term care facilities. Pray for the people of Ukraine, refugees from around the world. We pray for all those who are prisoners of war. In our Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the Church of the province of Southeast Asia. That they may be comforted and strengthened, let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That he might send the fire of the Holy Spirit upon his people, that we may bear faithful witness to his resurrection, let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
We continue on page 191 with the confession and absolution. Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy, welcoming sinners and inviting them to this holy table. Let us now confess our sins, confident in our Lord's eternal forgiveness. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us stand in the presence of our Lord as we exchange the peace with one another. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
in his name. Amen. Our service continues on page 193 in your green service books with Eucharistic prayer number 1. Page 193. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right that we should praise you, gracious God, for you created all things. You formed us in your own image, male and female, you created us. When we turned away from you in sin, you did not cease to care for us, but opened a path of salvation for all people. You made a covenant with Israel, and through your servants Abraham and Sarah gave the promise of a blessing to all nations. Through Moses, you led your people from bondage to freedom. Through the prophets, you renewed your promise of salvation. Therefore, with them and with all your saints who have served you in every age, we give thanks and raise our voices to proclaim the glory of your name. On the night before he gave himself to death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, and gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Gracious God, his perfect sacrifice destroys the power of sin and death. By raising him to life, you give us life forevermore. Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is alive.
Christ is risen.
Christ is alive.
Recalling his death, proclaiming his resurrection, and looking for his coming again in glory, we offer you, Father, this bread and this cup. Send your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts, that all we eat and drink at this table may be one body and one holy people, a living sacrifice in Jesus Christ our Lord. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
We continue on page 211. Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power and glory, forever and ever.
Amen. On page 213, fractional sentence number 8. Lord, we died with you on the cross.
Now we are raised in your life.
We were buried in your tomb.
Now we share in your resurrection.
Live in us, and we may live in you. These are the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
So today we're going to go back to one of the practices that we had a while ago, and I really quite miss it because I like seeing people together. So if you're with your spouse or someone you're close to and you want to come up to the altar rail and both receive side by side instead of in a row, please do that. It's a little more fun for me, actually, and I'm sure it's more familiar to you. So, I mean, you live together, you sleep together, you might as well take communion together. I mean, just do it, okay? So, body and Paul.
Thank you.
14 in your Green Book of Alternative Services. Will the congregation please stand and pray? Father, you restored us to life by raising your Son from death. May we who receive this sacrament always be strengthened to do your will. In the name of Jesus Christ, the risen Lord. Amen. And glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the church in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in all the love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Blessed God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be amongst you this day and remain with you always. Amen. Our recessional hymn is number 388 in your blue hymn books. Glorious things of thee are spoken, number 388.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah.